Hey guys, my name is Rachel and welcome back to my channel. So today is going to be video number 2 in our little 3-part Halloween series. But before I get into the video, I just wanted to go ahead and say a special thank you to Michael for joining the Patreon family. I truly appreciate your support and every single other person who decides to join my Patreon. I honestly cannot express enough how thankful I am and how much I appreciate every single one of you. You guys are the ones who allow me to keep making videos and keep my channel going. With that being said, let's just get right into today's video. Now, the case that I have for you guys today is such a bizarre case that it is literally going to blow your mind and leave you with so many freaking questions. This case is such a roller coaster, and when I was researching, I just could not believe how this entire thing went down. This is one of those cases where I just cannot wait to hear everyone's theories because I have absolutely no idea what to think. Now, I do want to warn you that this case does involve a child, and I know that is a very sensitive area for some, if not most of us. So if you could just not stand to listen to cases that involve children, then this video is not for you. The details in this case are very hard to listen to, so this is basically your warning for that. But either way, with that being said, today we are going to be talking about the very bizarre case of little Pauline Picard. Pauline Picard was only 2 years old when she went missing from her family's farm home in Gaillac-au-Ladoux, France in April of 1922. Now, the day that she went missing, Pauline was just having a normal day playing outside. The area was quiet and very safe, so Pauline's mother never worried or even thought twice about letting her children play outside on their farmland. However, that evening, when Pauline's mother called her in for dinner, there was no response. Her mother was immediately in panic mode and gathered all of her neighbors and all of those in the neighborhood to go out and search for her. Now, as we kind of know, back in the early 1900s, people were not nearly as concerned with watching their children at all times and making sure that they were safe and kind of hovering over them. Things like this just did not happen very often, and when they did happen, most people didn't even really hear about it because the media was not as massive as it is today. So during this night, I'm assuming that Pauline was probably just playing outside while her mother was making dinner. I assume that her mother would have checked up on her occasionally, and the way it sounds, they had a pretty large farm with a decent amount of land, so there would have been a pretty short window of time for something to happen to her between her mother checking up on her and going back inside to make dinner without anyone noticing. So that was the very first strange thing about this disappearance. It's not like her parents were sleeping and this was the middle of the night. It's not like they were off at work and then she went missing. It's not like they weren't home and she went missing. They were home, and I assume her mother was checking up on her, and she went missing right out of the yard where they lived. Now, police and local volunteers searched tirelessly for Pauline, but found absolutely no trace of her. When the 3-week mark came and went, people were really starting to lose hope and were assuming that she must have just been eaten by a boar or taken by somebody. However, a few weeks after her disappearance, Pauline's parents received some amazing and relieving news. There was a young girl found wandering alone in Cherbourg, over 300 miles away from their home, who matched Pauline's exact description. The police brought her mother a photo of this little girl, and her mother just knew that it was Pauline. As soon as she saw this picture, she burst into tears and said, "That's my daughter, my poor little Pauline." They had no idea how their daughter could have managed to get 300 miles away unless she was taken there by somebody. If she was taken there by someone, though, who was it and why? So Pauline's parents, of course, headed straight over to Cherbourg to pick up their missing daughter. When they picked her up, though, she did seem a little off. She didn't really respond when her parents were talking to her, and she seemed a little bit distant, and she didn't really seem to understand their accent. However, this little girl had just gone through this massive trauma. She somehow ended 300 miles away from her home and had been away from her family for weeks. Who knew what could have happened to her in that time frame? People started to believe that she was kidnapped and abused. Now, just before this little girl was taken by the authorities, she was with a woman who looked poor and seemed to be dressed in rags. The media reported that she was the key to knowing exactly what happened to Pauline, kind of alluding towards her possibly being the one who took her. Newspapers all over France were reporting of this extremely strange yet joyful reunion of a missing little girl and her parents. But a lot of people thought that this was just such a strange situation and kept telling the family that this little girl was not Pauline. Again, she was found so far away from her home and she barely seemed to recognize or understand her parents when they spoke to her. The family was starting to question the situation, whether this really was their daughter, but they still tried to hang on to the belief that this was Pauline. This was until a local farmer, Yves Martin, seemed to have actually confessed to being the one to take and harm Pauline. He went up to the Picards looking very shaky and nervous and asked the parents if they were sure that this little girl was actually Pauline, and then just ran off screaming, "God help me, I'm guilty." The Picards didn't really know what to make of the situation because this guy did seem pretty off, and he was later actually admitted to a mental hospital, so he clearly had some mental issues. So was he just delusional and trying to provoke this family for some reason, or was he really trying to admit to something horrific? Either way, the Picards were really starting to question the identity of the little girl that was living in their home. They really weren't sure what to make of the situation until a few days later when a horrifying discovery was made. A neighboring farmer of theirs was walking across the family's farm when he found the body of a very young girl who was completely decapitated, disfigured, and naked with a skull laying nearby. This man immediately went to police to investigate this body along with the Picards. This body was so horrifically damaged and disfigured that it was absolutely beyond recognition. There was no possible way that they would be able to identify this young child simply by looks. However, Pauline's mother was absolutely horrified when she realized that the clothes on this body, which included a black and white checkered dress, a navy blue jacket, and black tights, were the exact clothes that Pauline was wearing when she went missing. This was extremely strange because the location that she was found was very extensively searched for weeks after her disappearance, so the authorities thought that she was most likely placed there long after their searches, right before she was found. I'm not exactly sure how the scene looked, so I'm not exactly sure if it looked like it had taken place there, meaning there was blood and signs of a struggle, or if she had been killed and then placed there later. None of the sources come out and say when or where they believed that she was killed, but I assume that they probably gathered that she was killed before this and then ended up there afterwards. Now, the next incredibly bizarre thing in this case is that when they did an autopsy of the skull found near Pauline's body, it turns out that it was actually somebody else's skull. The skull was too large to belong to a child, and in fact, it was even too large to belong to a woman. The skull belonged to some random, unidentified, grown man. This turned the case into an entirely new investigation. Now there wasn't just a child, but a full-grown man who looks to have been killed by the same person. They tried to search and figure out who the skull belonged to, but they could not find any matches. So now they had this brutally disfigured body of a sweet little girl and the skull of some unidentified grown man and someone who was responsible for both of these just running loose. So of course, after discovering the body of this little girl, it was obvious that this little girl from Cherbourg was not Pauline. It was almost like they had to go through the grief of losing their daughter three separate times. Once when they realized that she was missing, another when they found her body, and then when they realized that the one glimmer of hope they had in this little girl was just a complete and utter heartbreak. This little girl from Cherbourg was not their daughter, so they had to take her back where she came from. She didn't have a home to go to though, so she was actually just sent to an orphanage. After this, we have no idea what happened to the little girl, and that is just so sad to me. Why was this little girl just wandering the streets before she was found? Who was supposed to be taking care of her? And why did no one come looking for her after she was moved in with this new family and was all over the news? Unfortunately, this case has never reached any sort of satisfying conclusion. We are just left with so many more questions than answers. Who did this skull belong to? Who was responsible for taking the life of a young, innocent child and possibly another fully grown male? Did the skull belong to the person responsible, or was it really Yves Martin who had admitted to doing this crime? Was it a complete stranger, and who is this little girl from Cherbourg? Who are her parents, and why did Pauline's parents so confidently think that this was their child? These are all questions that even almost 100 years later, we have no answers to. Even with the Picard's identification of the body, it still can't even be 100% confirmed that it was her because of how unrecognizable she was at the time, and DNA testing just was not a thing. So it would have been almost completely impossible to 100% identify this body as being Pauline. As for the Picards misidentifying this little girl as Pauline, it's very possible that they were just so overcome with grief that they would have accepted almost anyone who even remotely looked like their daughter as their daughter. They could have been so desperate that they really thought that this was Pauline. As for the murderer, we still have absolutely no answers on who took this young, innocent life, whether it was Pauline or not, and we likely never will. So now I want to go over a couple of the theories in this case. So the first theory is that everything in this case is exactly how it played out. So the little girl from Cherbourg was just a case of mistaken identity, and the body found did belong to Pauline. And in this theory, Yves Martin is the one who is responsible. Now, clearly we know that there was this skull found near Pauline's body, so that means that she was not the first victim. If he was their neighbor, which I'm not exactly sure if he was, but if he was, it's possible that the family had seen him multiple times and never really thought anything of it. Maybe if he did live nearby, he knew the family's schedule and everything, and was maybe even familiar with the family and knew everyone. Maybe he knew the times when Pauline's mother made dinner, and he knew that she wouldn't be paying as much attention while cooking, and took that opportunity to abduct Pauline. Then he maybe took her to his own farm, harmed her, and waited for the searches to end, because again, if he was a neighbor, he would have been able to see everything that was happening, and then as soon as he knew that the heat was off, he placed her body in that location when he knew that he wouldn't get caught. It honestly would have been the perfect time to place her body there if he knew that no one was looking for her, since they thought that they had already found her. Maybe he decided to taunt the family by placing this random skull nearby, and maybe he was taunting the family or even felt a little guilty when he approached them. We do know that he has severe enough mental issues to end up in a mental asylum, so it's possible that he was mentally unwell enough to commit these crimes against multiple people. So the next theory is basically the same as above, but that the skull found belonged to Pauline's actual killer, and maybe the person that killed whoever the skull belonged to was someone who was possibly getting revenge for Pauline's murder. We all know that the most hated criminals of all times are those who harm children. Maybe someone found out who harmed Pauline and then decided to take justice into his own hands. That would explain the skull that was found next to Pauline more so than in the first theory, where we don't really know the motive for placing this random victim's skull nearby. I do think that this theory is very possible, and if there was more theory that I would like to be true, I think it would be this one, because at least the person responsible for taking the life of this innocent little child is no longer able to do it again. Obviously, in that time period, they're probably deceased by now because it's been almost 100 years, but you know what I mean? But still, I just don't know how likely this theory is. So one of the more interesting theories is that the little girl from Cherbourg really was Pauline, and that this was possibly either a big conspiracy or someone just really trying to mess with the family. So like I said earlier, nothing was definitively done to 100% say that this body was Pauline's. It's possible that someone kidnapped Pauline, dropped her off in Schoenberg somehow, switched her clothes with another child, and then staged this entire thing. Or it could be possible that this wasn't a conspiracy, but the child was Pauline, the child from Cherbourg. But due to her weird behaviors and when the body was found, her mother misremembered the clothes she was wearing and assumed it was Pauline. The parents already had doubts in their head about who this child was, and no parent wants to find their child dead. But if they were already having all these questions and doubts and people telling them that this wasn't Pauline, and then they found this little girl dead in their backyard, it's possible that they misidentified this body as being Pauline. Now, this theory doesn't really explain the skull that is found, but I want to focus more so on Pauline in this theory, because the skull either belonged to her or a stranger of someone who had previously killed before, and we honestly don't know why the skull was there. There's no plausible explanation, and there's really no reason for it to be there. There's really not much more to theorize about the skull, honestly. So those are pretty much the three main theories that I could come up with in this case. Many people are pretty comfortable with thinking that this body did belong to Pauline and that this other little girl was just a misidentification. I do think that that is the least complicated theory. As for who killed her, a lot of people are split on whether they think that it was the neighbor or not. I honestly think that is a very strong possibility, and as for the skull, I think it's very likely that whoever killed Pauline also killed this other unidentified man and placed the skull near the body for whatever reason. I think it's pretty obvious that whoever did this was probably a serial killer and, you know, put the skull there for whatever sick, twisted reason that none of us could ever understand. I just feel like this is one of the strangest cases that I've ever looked into, and I think a lot of the mystery can be attributed to the time. I don't think something like this would ever happen today, especially with the advances that we have in DNA and technology. I don't really know which theory I believe in most, because there are just so many strange things about this case, and whatever happened might not even be something that we went over in the theories, because it's just so strange and there's so many things that could have happened, and it's just truly baffling. So now I want to know what you guys think, and I honestly cannot wait to hear your guys' thoughts on this insane case. Do you think that the neighbor was responsible? Do you think that it was someone else? Who do you think that the skull belonged to, and who is this other random little girl? Please let us know in the comments below. So that is all I have for this video in our Halloween series. If you like this video, please make sure to leave this video a thumbs up and subscribe to my channel so you don't miss out on the next video in our little Halloween series. Don't forget to follow my Twitter and Instagram. Both will be linked in the description box below. Also, if you wish to help support this channel, my Patreon is linked in the description box below. If you have absolutely any case suggestions, please do not hesitate to send them over to my email at rachelshannoncases@gmail.com. With that, I hope you guys have a great rest of your day, and I hope to see you in my next Halloween video. Bye!